So let me get into this. I'm like really distracted. Hey. So why is creating money important? Why is the person that actually, or the entity that actually has that power of creating money, why is it important? And it's because by creating money, these banks provide the exchange media, which this economy needs to prosper and to grow. Now, since the growth and the proper functioning of this United States corporation economy essentially requires increasing, the amount of money over the years, those entities or those organizations that control the money and control the amount of the money exercises, extreme power over business activities and the incomes that actually the people earn and their economical strength. So by Congress actually allowing the Federal Reserve Bank to control money, essentially they're giving them the power over the people. Now, the next question would be, it's like, why was the banking system given the right to create money? Like, well, why was they given this right? Because that was actually only given to Congress. So Congress is actually never given the authority to delegate that to anyone else. And so the reason, mainly when you look at it historically, the banks, they perform a service in creating the money. Now, once the money and the credit was actually created, someone actually have to decide whom to give the money and what purpose is the money is actually given for. So the banks now do this. So, and the banks doing this, the banks are earning the return for, placing the money and supplying the money to the, to the Congress or to the government. So the banks are actually getting paid from this. So the next question that should come to mind, like, what is the Federal Reserve? Because most people think that is, some federal institution and so on and so forth. But the Federal Reserve System is the so-called central bank of the country now. And it's composed, when people be doing like your accepted for values and so on and so forth, and you see those 12 banks, like, you'll go in and you'll look for your banking reference number, if you will. So that those are comprised of the Federal Reserves. So that central bank, it's composed of 12 different regions. And those are the 12 regions that people try and tap into for their TDA account. So there's 12 regional reserve banks, and the Federal Reserve Board in Washington, D.C. controls the ability of these commercial banks to create money and to create credit. So the Federal Reserve also controls the level of interest rate. Like, Congress is not controlling that. Now, so what about, does the Congress actually supervise the Federal Reserve policy making? Because if they're getting their power from Congress to actually create this money, is Congress actually supervising this? And the short answer is no. The short answer is no. The Federal Reserve is essentially independent in its policy making. So the Federal Reserve neither requires nor does it seek any kind of approval of any branch of government for its policies. So they're operating however they want to operate. So the system itself decides what ends its policies and what is going to actually be aimed at. And it actually takes whatever action it sees fit to reach those ends. So the Congress is actually not even controlling the Federal Reserve. So this, this has become like a 5,000-pound gorilla. And so, knowing thus, what problems are really caused or raised by an independent Federal Reserve? Because they're acting independently, they're acting without an act of Congress. And so, what this is doing is creating two major problems. One is the political responsibility for the country's economic policy, and the other is a problem of the final control over this de facto that you call government actions in the economical sphere. So the Federal Reserve is controlling that. So what is the problem with the political responsibility? How is that causing a problem? Well, the short answer is, since the Federal Reserve is independent, it is not accountable to anyone for its economical policies, that whatever it chooses to pursue. But this runs, you know, it's like counterproductive, should I say. It's counterproductive with their so-called democratic policies. So the president and Congress are actually responsible, like Donald Trump right now, to the people on election day for the past economical decisions. But how can they be responsible if the Federal Reserve is acting at its own free will? But the Federal Reserve is responsible neither to the people directly nor indirectly, although the people elected the representatives. But the Federal Reserve are not responsible to them. So the Federal Reserve exercises great power in controlling the money creating activities of all of the commercial banks. So, you know, knowing this, why is the final control of economics policy a problem? How are they causing a problem with this? Because this is like designed to show you where all of these problems are really coming from with the money. And so it's because an independent Federal Reserve, Congress, and president can be moving in one direction while the Federal Reserve is moving in the other direction. So they're not listening to Donald Trump. They're not doing what Donald Trump wants to do. And the result is sometimes you don't really have any policy at all because the Federal Reserve is moving in this direction and the president and Congress is moving in the other direction. So at other times, it actually leads the Federal Reserve to actually neutralizing the president's economic plans. So they are literally controlling him. So this very possibility is what happened with this guy, Lyndon B. Johnson. You know, it caused him to request the Federal Reserve in 1964 annual economic report to Congress and to nullify and reduce the unemployment. So they didn't like Lyndon B. Johnson before that. Now, the president should, you know, have to ask government agencies, you know, along with, you know, his so-called policy approved by Congress, you know, certain things. But I mean, so when you really look at it, the Federal Reserve Bank essentially is controlling both the president and Congress. So you see Donald Trump, you know, he's speaking on TV as if he's really in control, but the Federal Reserve Bank is literally controlling both Donald Trump and Congress. So who really directs the Federal Reserve's operation? Who's directing them then? If they're controlling the Congress and the President of the United States Corporation. So essentially, day-to-day operations in each of these 12 regional banks, you know how like when you're doing the acceptance for value thing, you go and you look at your account number and you see which regional bank is actually holding that. Well, one of these, you know, all of these 12 regional banks of the Federal Reserve are actually supervised by 9 directors. 6 of them are selected directly by their privately owned commercial bank. But the most important monetary decisions for the system as a whole is made by the Open Market Committee, which is actually composed of 12 members. And you can go and look this stuff up that I'm talking about. You know, you could Google Open Market Committee. So the private bank entrance actually influences the Federal Reserve policies. So of these 12 members of the Open Market Committee, you might want to write that down, the Open Market Committee. The Open Market Committee, which actually controls the credit policy, because they control the credit policies. There are 5 presidents of regional banks. So the presidents are elected by individual regional banks. So they have what is known as a 9-man board of directors, which, you know, are really private commercial banks. And these are actually representatives. And so they also have, of these 12 regional banks, they have the presidents participate in the open market committee with, you know, their discussions, and then they vote on who these five people are going to be. And the decisions of this open market committee, they have 19 members. So the 12 regional bank presidents, and this stuff is like all leading back to their secret handshakes and their masonry and so on and so forth. But does it matter what amount of money is actually supplied to the economy? Yes, it does. See, the money supply helps determine the general level of interest rates paid for the use of money. So depending on how much money the Federal Reserve supplies, that's going to determine the interest rate that is actually paid for the use of money. Because guess what? The United States Corporation is paying them for the use of their money, because these Federal Reserve notes don't belong to the United States Corporation. So it determines the amount of interest rate that's paid on employment. It determines the amount of interest rate that's paid on prices. It determines the amount of interest rate that's paid on economical growth. So many economists actually believe that the money supply is most important and is detrimental because of these variables. So who is really determining the money supply? The Federal Open Market Committee of the Federal Reserve System. They're determining it. And so why the interest charge in the first place? If the government knows this, why? Because if they're charging the government interest, guess what they do with you? They tax you more. And so they charge this interest rate for many different reasons. The first being, it pays a large part in the cost of living. All business firms borrows to conduct their operation. So they know this, these people are going to borrow from them, so they put a high interest rate on it. So the Federal Reserve is actually getting paid hand over fist, and that this fiat that they're creating, it's not really backed by nothing, but they're literally charging your de facto an interest rate on it. So, and these interest rates change at random.
It's just like a rental. Right.
So, but what happens with these interest rates? You know, does these interest rate actually affect, you know, efficiency costs of a high interest? So what essentially happens is when investment is cut by high interest, two things essentially happens. The business do not take as much advantage of the new and more efficient tools to produce goods that it would have actually done. And the other thing is that the industry slows down the rate of expansions of the total output capacity and the country's factories. So the more interest rates that the Federal Reserve charges, guess what? They're able to produce less jobs, because these people are not able to pay as much because the Federal Reserve is charging them a higher interest rate. This is why people don't like the banksters, because the banksters are really who's really controlling the world. The banksters are controlling the government and everybody. And the banksters are these Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, you know, the so-called, you know, Jewish people that everybody seemed to be at odds with. And when you look into the history, you'll see sometimes it could be for good reason, because they're controlling the world by their banks and so on and so forth, charging interest rates on, you know, money that really doesn't even exist. So the results of these twin effects is that tomorrow's workers work with less efficient machinery because they can't produce the factories and fewer machines than they might have otherwise. So having fewer or less efficient tools tomorrow, the workers are less productive. So in other words, the rate of growth or output slackens with these highest interest rates. So when the Federal Reserve prevails with higher interest rates, the workload is actually less. So, and they've been doing this for a while now. And so when you see, well, the job market go down, and you think it's the government, it's the Federal Reserve that's really controlling that. But they wouldn't have actually been able to do this if Congress didn't give them the power to do this. So now Congress is actually giving them the power to do this. Now they have Congress in a place where they can't take that power back because the banksters are essentially controlling the world. They're controlling the whole world. So, you know, this government that most people think is like really loyal and so on and so forth. And though, so what happens is these people with the high interest rates, they raise inflation. So people can't afford medical insurance. It causes, like, for example, the Great Depression. It was strategically staged to cause a deterrent. So, you know, knowing this, so what the Federal Reserve is controlling all of this, they're controlling that Federal Reserve note. And, you know, most of us on the call probably know that's not money. So the question should become, what is money? What is money? Anybody know what is money? Anyone in the room? I don't think we're muted. So, I mean, what is money? Anyone in the room want to give a shot at that? Brother Lone, anyone? What is money?
Money is what we use to trade.
Right. Yeah. So money essentially is anything that people will accept in exchange for goods or services. Now, I want you to stop and think about that, because a lot of you, and this is not my definition, that's their definition. So if money is anything that people use, anything that people will accept in exchange for goods and services, you know, in belief that they may in turn exchange it now or later for goods or services. So if a company sends me a bill and I turn that into a remittance and put my signature on it and my account number, can I refer to that as money? Is that money? Is that not money? If money is anything that people will accept in exchange for goods and services, would that not be money? And I'm turning it into a remittance. Is that money? Anyone? Is that money? Is a paper, let me put it to you like this. Is a paper IOU, a Federal Reserve note, money? It may serve as money. If it's anything that people, would do in exchange of goods and services. Hey, I see a type. It's, what do you know? It's KO.
I just want you to know that your video is coming through pretty clear too.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'm on a new Mac. So yeah. Is it in color? Because it looks in black and white over here.
Yeah, it's in color, and I hung up my phone, so right now it's just through my mic on my laptop also.
Yeah, that's how I'm operating. So basically, KO, can you hear me? I just see you typing. Can you speak? Yeah, you're breaking up. You're coming through distorted. I can't really hear you talking. So an IOU could, may serve as money, according to their definition of money. Now, how money functions and what money represents, it should be very important aspects. So today, I won't say the American people, I'll say the people of the United States, use coins, they use currency, they use paper money and bank deposits, they use checkbook money, they use all of this as money. So what did Americans use for money in earlier times? Well, what did they use? So in the beginning of times, what did they, the caller from 704, the brother from 704, what did people use for money in earlier times? Caller, are you there?
Hello? Hello?
Everybody muted? Is that what's going on? Hello? Yeah. I mean, you should be able to unmute yourself. I just unmuted. You guys have a party over there. Oh, that's 919. It's Daryl, right? 551. So
yeah.
Is Yaya Ben?
Yes, that's me.
Yeah. So I mean, what do you, in the beginning, what did Americans use for money in earlier time?
I believe it was silver and gold, am I correct?
Yeah, yeah, I mean, even before that, when we go back, I'm talking way, you know, before they used the silver and gold. Anyone knows? Because they was using something before they used silver and gold. We're going to history. See, I'm a historian. I be digging deep in there. They done.
Wasn't it their time? Like, you know, I give you time. Yeah, to help
they use something known as wapama.
I know that people back in the day, they used their services, their labors, and their talent. If someone had the means to go cultivate sugar or any type of crop, they will barter with the next person with their services.
Right. Well, there's something known, anyone knows what wapama is? Essentially, that's what the American people was actually using even before silver and gold.
I never heard of palm.
Yeah, it's called what palm? That it's W. Someone Google that up and post it in the room so they can see what that is. It's WAMPUM. So it was just a bunch of clamshells strung like bees, where, you know, that they was actually using as money, you know, to settle the debts. You know, I'm talking, you're going back to the time of the settlers, these people that was calling themselves settlers. But, you know, the people that they refer to as native are, you know, they call them native, you know, Indians, the Native Americans. They use wapama as money. The settlers use, like, so-called clam shells, you know, string together like bees. But, you know, the tribe of Gad, so-called Native Americans, was using what they call wapama as money. And so when the settlers wanted to trade with these people that they call Indians, you know, according to the scriptures, the tribe of Gad, they did so with the wapama. You know, they had to use the wapama with the natives. So the settlers themselves, they started using what's referred to as wapama as money. And anyone look that up and see what that...
I did. I looked it up. It says wampum. The dictionary definition is a quantity of small cylindrical beads made by North American Indians from quahog shells strung together, worn as a decorative belt or used as a money exchange.
Right. So as you see, you know, our people had this system of money before it, you know, before they even came here, before they. So-called, you know, Gentiles actually even came into the country, because they was trying to use clamshells and all of that, and we was actually using this. But when they essentially wanted to trade with our people, they had to, you know, use the wapama. Now, these people that they call colonists, you know, and if there's any Gentiles in the room, in the Edomites, this is not meant to be offensive, it's just the truth. Now, these people, you know, that, you know, call colonists, because you colonize, you know, the indigenous people of the land, did they use coins at all? You know, anyone want to take a shot? Did these colonists use any kind of coins? Yeah, well, since no one knows, yes, they use coins, because they traded with the Europeans also. They traded with the people in Europe, as well as the people that they referred to as Indians, so they used coins too. Now, naturally, there was a rate of exchange between the wapama and the coins, since both of them was used. So when, you know, in 1641, the New Amsterdam Council, and for to those of you that don't know, New York, before it was called New York, it was called New Amsterdam. So what is known as the New Amsterdam Council, they fixed the rate of exchange between wapama and what's known as Dutch money. So as time passed, these colonies started minting their own coins, and their general use of wapama died out. So the Euro Gentiles making a lot of noise back then. Oh, that's the 919 number again. So, the you know, typically what they did is they phased out, and a lot of people don't know this history. So they think that Esau brought everything here. So what they did is they came here and they gradually phased out every freaking thing that we was doing, that our people had a history of doing. So, you know, the Israelites that was on this side was actually using wampum. So Esau eventually came in and he started minting money, and then he eventually phased the wampum out. So then, you start dealing with tobacco. If you know the history, like, they didn't know how to grow tobacco. Our people, the so-called indigenous, Moors, you wanna call them Moors or Hebrews, they taught them how to grow tobacco and so on and so forth. So when corn money became short, the colonies devised all sorts of money. They started coming up with all sorts of things as money. And so one of the things, and this is in Virginia, in Maryland, and in North Carolina, that they used was tobacco, these tobacco warehouse receipts as money. So they would essentially use a tobacco warehouse receipt as money. So these receipts were originally issued to tobacco growers when they placed their crops in storage that was actually waiting to be sold. So the owner of these, tobacco things simply made their receipts transferable much, it's just like, if someone was actually endorsing a check today. So that's what the tobacco receipt represented. So as the tobacco prices actually fluctuated, making it like an imperfect medium of exchange to hold as a savings, they started to actually shy away from that as well. So then, they started talking about legal tender. So what, because you hear some people saying it's still legal tender, but essentially what is legal tender? Legal tender is actually any form of money which the United States de facto, which you refer to as government, declares good for payment of taxes and for both public and private debts. So whatever the U.S. considers to be good for payment of taxes and debt is supposed to be legal tender. But what is the most important form of money in the United States today? Anyone want to take a shot at that? Did everyone get muted? 551. Okay. 551.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. You was muted.
Yeah, I have no idea. And just for the record, everybody, to unmute yourself, it's you press *6 and you can unmute yourself like that.
Yeah,
but yeah. I don't know, Kenny.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
I say it's gold.
who is that?
It's 704.
Yeah. Appreciate that, KO. That link. Yeah, I mean, by the way, if you go to my website, like, I have all the versions of Black Lord's Dictionary posted on the website. If you go to the website, like on the resource pages, like, you could download like a lot of things for free. I got a lot of resources there. I don't think people really go there. But if you go there and download everything that's on that page, you should be able to get, I think I got Bouvier's Dictionary listed there.
Wow.
Black Lord's Dictionary from version 1 to up to the 9th version. I think I have corporate federalism listed there. There's a lot of things listed on the sites if you actually go to the resource pages. So the most important form of money in the United States is essentially what they refer to as checkbook money. That is actually demand deposits in commercial banks. So they refer to that as checkbook money. And so they account for 80% of all the money in circulation in the country, the kind of money that you could actually deposit into these commercial banks. But who issues money? Now, since the Revolutionary War, the United States government has minted coins and printed money that they refer to as currency. Now, there's other goods, including like the tobacco receipts that was actually once in circulation as money. Now, they weren't considered to be legal tender. So, since the 19th century, the government delegated its right to print legal tender money first to the state banks, then to the national banks, which is essentially the Federal Reserve banks. But in today's system, who actually issues coins? Well, anyone knows that? Because, I mean, when you're doing this inceptive value and all of this, this type of stuff becomes important to know this. You know, it's important to know this history. So if no one knows, only the United States Treasury has the right to mint pennies, nickels, dimes, quarters, and half a dollars, and silver dollars. Federal Reserve don't have a right to do that. Then they are issued through the Federal Reserve Bank. So the Federal Reserve don't have the authority to mint those. So what's going on is that the United States Treasury has the right to mint these, then they issue them through the Federal Reserve Banks. So these pennies are made of copper, the rest are made of alloy. They're not even made of nickel or silver or anything anymore. And that's been going on since 1934. Since 1934, the Treasury has minted no gold coins. They don't do it anymore. They stopped doing it in 1934. Now remember, mind you, that the gold order was placed into effect when? In 1933. So since 1934, they haven't been minting any gold coins. Now I got a question. What is currency? Anyone, what is currency? Rachel, what is currency? Anyone? Ms. Walker, you in the room?
Legal tender?
I can answer that question, Tazadaq.
Who's this? I mean, if I could ask, who's this? Who's that right there? Corla?
Hey. The legal tender? The legal tender is only a monopoly that's monetized by the government. It's not lawful money.
Yeah. What was your name again?
It's Alicia.
All right, yeah, I'm just the voice don't sound familiar. Anyways, so, I mean, what did you say it was again, sister?
The legal tender is only something that's monetized by the government. It's only used for their monopoly. It's not lawful money that means anything.
All right. Yeah, so currency is, it's like paper money or money that you could fold. But believe it or not, that's what they consider to be currency. So, The Americans use several forms of currency. Now you have what is known as national bank notes. You have Federal Reserve notes. You had what is known as silver certificates. They're not in circulation too much anymore. Then you have treasury notes of 1890. So all of these were considered to be currency. Any paper that you could actually fold, they consider that to be like currency. So that was like, you know, national bank notes, Federal Reserve notes, which are still in existence, silver certificates, which was actually real money because they had silver in them, and the Treasury notes of 1890. And you had U.S. notes and Federal Reserve bank notes. Now, about 94% of the currency in circulation today is what? Everyone should know that. It's Federal Reserve notes. Federal Reserve notes, which are essentially right. IOUs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so I got a quick, Yaya Bey, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
So, since, you know, knowing this, has any private institutions ever issued money? Anyone, not just Yaya Bey, has any private institutions ever issued money?
No.
Mm-hmm.
What about anyone else? Rachel. Rachel, you in the core? Oh, Kale Snow, she's muted. No. Kale Snow's unmuted. Well, the answer is actually yes. So in the 19th century, currency was actually issued by private state banks. So any private company that could actually obtain a charter to conduct a bank could actually issue these notes. So the state bank notes disappeared when the National Bank Act was passed in 1863. So why was the National Bank Act really passed? It was passed because the government wanted a reliable money with uniform value issued by reliable institution. At least that's what they said in every section of the country. So to finance the growing production and the trade. So the national banks only lost the privilege of issuing banknotes in 1913. A lot of things actually happened in that year. If you actually been to any of my seminars, by 1913, they really done a lot of damage. So who issues the money today? Is it private banks? Who was that? Someone said the Treasury?
Yes.
So do private banks issue money today? Let me put it that way. Does private banks issue money? No?
No.
Who's that? Can't make out the voice.
Miss Walker.
Yeah. So private banks do issue money today. So they no longer have the right to issue banknotes. They can create money in the form of bank deposits when they lend money to businesses or to buy securities. So even though they're not doing the banknote, they could do it in the form of deposits and so on and so forth. So let me ask you this. So the dollar used to be backed by gold and silver. What is it backed by now? Anyone knows?
Backed by the labor of the people.
Yeah. Sweat equity.
Yeah, energy and time.
Yep, labor.
Transmitting utility.
No. Yeah, well, yeah, that was actually the right answer. So, you know, has the United States gone off of the gold standard?
Anyway. Yes.
Yeah, they have. But
yes.
But yeah, I'll tell you something else. When they do international transactions, they're still on the gold standard. So they're still on the gold standard when they do international transactions. Remember, they have gold on the stock market.
Yes.
So knowing that, does this actually change the basis of our money? Not really.
Not really.
But
no.
In 1934, this action that, you know, Congress took, it just essentially formalized what had actually been true all along, which is that since the 19th century, checkbook money, and now 80% of our money supply, has replaced notes as the most important form of money. So checkbook money is actually created on the basis of all kinds of variables and assets. So when a bank makes a loan to a business firm, it's actually secured by inventories of machinery or to a form or to like a secured form asset. It has no effect, you know, on the created dollar, or it's actually backed by inventories, machinery, or form goods. So, you know, what kind of dollar, you know, do you have in the United States today? What kind of dollar do you have? Hold on.
a worthless one.
Yeah, so I mean, so essentially what you have is like a managed paper currency. And I call it managed because an agency of the federal government, the Federal Reserve System, consciously determines and controls the maximum amount of money which can actually be created by the bank and lender. So the Federal Reserve is determining this. Yeah, that was you again. All right, so so can everyone still hear me that was actually listening? Because I muted someone that was actually making that background noise.
I can hear you.
All right, cool, cool.
I can hear you.
So who does the Constitution give the power over money? According to the Constitution, I cannot reword that. Who has power over money according to the Constitution?
Congress.
Right. Absolutely.
Congress.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So the Constitution gave power to Congress to like coin and to regulate the money. The Supreme Court has actually interpreted this clause again and again over 150 years to mean that whatever power there is over the currency is vested in the Congress. So at what point did Congress have the power to like give this to the Federal Reserve Bank? They didn't. They didn't.
No.
Now, I got a question. How's money created then? How's it created? Anyone knows that? I talked about this in a video probably like a year ago. So anyone knows?
By the credit of the people of America.
Right. So anyone ever heard about goldsmiths? I talked about this in a video probably like 4 or 5 years ago. Because that's how essentially how money was created. It's what is known as this fractional reserve method of banking. So the fractional reserve method of banking originated. What's cool right there? Who's rattling this paper, man? This is going to cause me to move everywhere, man. Who is this? Yeah, so I'm going to mute everyone. And if you want to unmute yourself, I believe it's *6 or *7 to unmute yourself, because that is kind of annoying. So the fractional reserve banking method was originated by these people known as goldsmiths. So the predecessor of these present banksters, or these Rothschilds and so on and so forth. So this method of banking is still used today. Now, essentially, it is a system where bankers maintain as reserves only a fraction of the amount that's needed. So what I'm saying is that these banks are essentially loaning money that they really don't have. Because what they determine is that when these goldsmiths would actually, you know, when you look into history, people was carrying around gold coins. But when they started making, you know, large supplies of money, the gold coins became too much to carry around in their pockets and so on and so forth. So they would take their gold coins into a goldsmith, and the goldsmith would give them a receipt. So this was actually, you know, what the goldsmith started realizing is that the people would not come back for all of the money at once. So these goldsmiths were started loaning out the money. But what they would do, since the people was not coming to get, you know, 100% of the money, they would come and get like about 70%, 50%. So the goldsmith would actually loan out, you know, that percentage that, you know, more than what was actually being taken out. So they was loaning money that wasn't actually even there. And so this was actually fractional reserve banking. So they was telling people that they had money that they really didn't have. They was really loaning out someone else's actually money or gold that they had actually deposited in the bank. And so someone else would actually come and borrow that money, and they started charging them like an interest on it. So they make these banksters maintain what is known as only a fraction of the money that the people would put in the bank. They was loaning the other people's money out that they was actually depositing into the bank. So these obligations to the bank that people should have, you know, how can I put this to make this like simple, like someone would actually go in, let's say if I went and deposit like $100 worth of gold coins into the bank. So the bank, even if I withdrew, if I came and withdrew 20% of that, the bank would act as if I still had that whole 100% there, that whole $100 worth of gold, and they will loan it to someone else when they really didn't have the money. So the goldsmith stuck upon this method by noticing that the people who deposit gold with them for safekeeping only claim a small portion of the gold at one time. So knowing this, the goldsmith realized that they can lend out a good portion of the gold that was left with them. So they wasn't supposed to be doing this, but this is how the whole fractional reserve banking system started. So when they realized that people wasn't coming back for all of that money, they started loaning out those people money. So the goldsmith realized that they could actually loan this money out. So they made loans. This is where the loan system came from, which in fact were not gold, but was warehouse receipts. So they would tell the people, oh, well, you could borrow this. And they would, you know, give them like a warehouse receipt, which was a loan. So these receipts circulated as money. They were circulating as there was gold. And you notice that the gold actually, you know, these certificates of ownerships was actually being loaned by the goldsmith, you know, and they wasn't supposed to lend this. They wasn't supposed to do this. So because they didn't own it. So they was lending something that didn't even belong to them because it was someone else's money that they were supposed to be just holding. It was someone else's gold. So in other words, the goldsmiths wrote receipts to people who were not depositing the gold. You understand what I'm saying? So someone would come and say, well, I want to, can you loan me $100 in gold? So the goldsmith will write them a loan, even if that person hadn't deposited nothing in the bank. What they was giving them was someone else's gold, which was illegal. So they was loaning out gold that did not belong to them. They didn't own it. So they just simply wrote these people gold who were not depositing receipts. These people was known as borrowers. So receipts for more gold than the goldsmith actually had in their vaults was actually circulating. Because anyone that wanted to come and borrow money, or borrow gold, which is real money, they would just simply write them a receipt. And so these goldsmiths started loaning out more receipts, and then they didn't even have the gold to back it. So the goldsmith only had a fraction of the gold that they claimed that they had, that they would actually supposedly be lending out, but they didn't have it. They was just given receipts and claiming that they had this. And so this became known as fractional reserve banking because they only had a fraction of what they was learning. But in the bank, they only had a fraction of that gold. So when banks of the United States kept these reserves in gold, they reserved amounted to small fractions of the amount of the money that they actually had issued. So, and there was no guaranteed redeemable on this gold. So the advantage of this fractional reserve system was that these fractional reserve banks provided a source of funds, which they actually invested in sound economic projects, and then they encourage like a lot of different business opportunities. But the major weaknesses of this fractional reserve system is that since the bank could not meet the claims on demand, if someone came and said, hey, listen, I want all of my gold, they wouldn't have had the person's gold. So the fractional reserve banking leaves that individual vulnerable to ruins. Because if all the people came in that had actually deposited their gold into the bank, the fractional reserve bank didn't have it. So this is why a central bank reserves was actually created to lend and to transfer reserves in the time of need. So this is why they actually created what is known as the central reserve bank. So they still use the same system in modern banking. Reserves in modern banks are banks, you know, that's actually making these deposits on demand. So this commercialized banking or this fractional reserve banking is still being used today. So people are going to banks and they'll get loans, and the banks don't really have it. They don't really have it. So what they're doing is they're loaning you someone else's fiat, which is supposed to be illegal. It's supposed to be illegal. So who determines how much checkbook money a bank can create? Who's controlling this? Because what they started doing, so once the gold was actually taken out of circulation, they started creating paper money out of thin air. So who's controlling that? Let me see, is someone asking a question here? Thieves. yeah, they are thieves. So 704, I think you could unmute yourself if you press star 6 or star 7.
I think.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I you got
it's the it's the Federal Reserve.
Yeah, yeah. What was that, good brother?
I said the Federal Reserve.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. So where? So where did the Federal Reserve get the money? With to create these bank reserves. It doesn't. It just it creates out of thin air. They don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
They just create it out of thin air.
Right, and the Federal Reserve notes, they like unsigned checks written on a closed account. You know, the Federal Reserve notes, it's like an inflatable paper system designed to create debt through inflation.
Right. So when the Federal Reserve writes a check, right, it's actually creating what they call money. So this can actually result in an increase in bank reserves. So what is known as a demand deposit or in cash. So if the customer prefers cash, he can actually demand the Federal Reserve notes, right? And so the Federal Reserve will have the Department of Treasury to simply print them. So the Federal Reserve
right. Is
a total money-making machine. That's all they're doing. It could actually issue money, or it could actually issue checks. It actually never has a problem of making its checks good because it can actually obtain $5 to $10 bills necessary to cover its costs for, you know, supplying the checks and asking the Department of Treasury for engraving them for them. So who actually really gives the Federal Reserve the power to create this money to cover its checks? Who's giving them the power? The Congress is.
Congress
does. The so-called government is doing this.
Right.
But so then, how does the Federal Reserve change the money supply? How do they change the money supply? Because you know how inflation goes up, so on and so forth. They do that by increasing and decreasing the amount of bank reserves, which the members of the banks of the Federal Reserve, you know, can actually have credits on the books with to the Federal Reserve Bank. And the next thing they do is by regulating, you know, these bank members, the maximum amount of bank deposit that they could actually create of these dollar reserves. So pretty much they control inflation when they want to. They create inflation when they want to. They pretty much control everything. They're controlling everything. Right.
Just arbitrarily just do as they please, basically.
Right. And
unlawfully.
Well, I mean, the Congress is actually giving them permission to do it, you know? And so now they're pretty much controlling the Congress now. Yeah, and the Federal Reserve, they purchase or they sell gold from the Department of Treasury.
Wow. Yeah, I'm just learning and trying to put it all, trying to connect all the dots, and
So let me ask you guys this: so if the government could like issue bonds, right? Because I know some of you have like government savings bonds and so on and so forth. How come they can't issue money and save interest? Because every time the Federal Reserve, has to print this money or whatever, they're charging the government interest. So why doesn't the government just like, issue its own money, to reserve interest?
I think because there is no real money. That, as of March 9, 1933, I think House Joint Resolution 192. Does that have anything to do with it?
Yeah, well, I mean, so it's because the Federal Reserve is charging interest, so that's how they're making their so-called fiat. So I don't know if I don't know if people know, is that Abraham Lincoln wanted to bring like real money back. Yeah, he wanted to bring the greenback back. And what happened? He was assassinated. And so he assassinated him for that. And I don't know if you know anything about President Kennedy's death. See, most people don't know the reason that President Kennedy was assassinated is because he was going to bring gold back into circulation, as real money. And he got assassinated also. So this is probably why they're not doing it.
Wow.
And so, they passed what is known as the Federal Reserve Act. Anyone knows what the Federal Reserve Act is? Let's talk about that at my
seminar. I have to do my research on that, sir.
Wasn't that the reason why they went into Iraq also?
What was that, brother?
Wasn't that the reason why they went into Iraq also? Because they were trying to establish their own money system also.
Yeah. So I mean, they create what is known as a central bank. And so, essentially a central bank has two functions. One is to serve as the banker's bank. And the other, it actually gives credit to the commercial banks, but it also holds the official reserves. Now, they also is to adjust the money supply through the powers to create reserves or to regulate the commercial banking system's ability to manufacture the money. So a bank which actually this is what the central bank does. So this kind of bank that perform these things, they are referred to as a central bank. So the Federal Reserve is a central bank. They are the central bank. So they're regulating all these other commercial banks.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a type of central bank that's actually controlling this you know, this whole system. And so, you know, they could devalue. So let me give you a scenario, right? And so this is how they create inflation, right? So let's say, like, if, you know, you were selling oranges, right? And the orange was like, you know, say it was like you had 10 oranges, right? And you were selling oranges, it was $1 per orange. So if you're selling oranges and it's $1 per orange, like, how much would 10 oranges cost you? $10, right? So, and this is how the Federal Reserve Bank rips people off and cheats them. So if I, you know, if I grew oranges, right? And so I wanted to go and sell my oranges is worth $10. So if I had like 1,000 oranges, I could take 1,000 oranges and cash them in for like $1,000. But let's say while I went to sleep that night, the Federal Reserve decided to print more banknotes, right? So, so instead of like it being like $1,000, let's say like the Federal Reserve prints it like $2,000 now. And so when I woke up the next morning, since they printed like $2,000 extra, now my oranges was just devalued, because now my oranges are actually only going to be worth like 50 cents an orange. So instead of my oranges actually being worth like $1,000, now 1,000 oranges, I'm only going to have $500. So that's how they create inflation, by printing money out of thin air. And so that devalues your product. So if something was actually worth something, and the Federal Reserve just to go inside, decide and print more money, that devalues whatever you was actually selling, its worthiness. It decreases it. So you lose out. And that's how inflation is actually created. So the more money that's actually in circulation, the less what you have is worth, because they, you know, they're creating inflation and so on and so forth. So it makes it devalues the product of what, you know, what it's actually been produced. So I don't know if you noticed, like, you know, anybody stays at hotels, right? You notice when you have like an event, like, let's say if it's like the 4th of July or something, right? Like, you'd be traveling during a regular day, right? You go to a hotel, it might be like $100 a night, right? But if you go during like a holiday, you go into the same hotel, nothing has changed. You know, you ask how much a room. Room might be like $200, $300 for the same room that you paid $100 for like a month ago. It's like, damn, I just stayed here. Right. Like, well, how are you charging me? Like, you know, because it's in high demand. So they use inflation on you because it's in high demand, because now you got a lot of people that's traveling during the holiday, same room that they will charge you for like $100 next week. But because it's a holiday and so many people are traveling, they're going to take advantage of you because they know that these rooms are in high demand now. So what they do, they use inflation. They put the price of the room up 2 to 3 times the amount, same room. Nothing's changed about the room, which I think should be illegal, but that's how they do it. They just inflate the price of it. Well, if you don't pay it, someone else is going to get it because everyone wants a place to stay. Or it could be like a major event. You know, like if you're in Vegas, like when I stayed in Vegas, like when they would have UFC events, like all of the hotels near the strip would go way up. And I don't mean like just like, you know, they, you know, they would have events in like the Mandalay Bay. Like the price of rooms would go way up because people would come from out of town and they wouldn't want to see the UFC. Man, don't you know like a little place like the Motel 6 that was usually only about $80, they pushed that room up to like $500 a night. So, I mean, they inflate things. This is how they ravage people. And so the other rooms, some of the other rooms, well, like that, $1,000, because there's this high demand to see the UFC. But this is how they inflate things, man, and just ravage people and take advantage of it. And so the government allows it. And, you know, to me, things like that should be illegal, but hey, it's not. They do it. And this is the same thing that the Federal Reserve does with money. They create inflation. Mm-mm-mm. So when they create inflation, when they want to control the society, they would just create inflation, and then your dollar bill becomes less. It becomes less. Mm-hmm. It becomes worth less, and then worth less. Like the more inflation that they create, it becomes worth less and less and less. You know, so you know, if my oranges, if they take more money out of circulation, hey, my oranges is worth less, worth less, worth less. So I mean, this is really what's going on with the money system, and these people, they determine the money supply and who's going to get what. So you know, the government is really not controlling the country anymore. The Federal Reserve is. The Federal Reserve, these banksters are controlling the world. But who controls that? Who controls the Federal Reserves? And they're private banks, by the way.
Wow.
So, I mean, they're really controlling the world. I mean, Meyer Rothschild said it. He said, you know, I don't care who controls the government, but if you allow me to control the people's money, then, you know, I can control the whole country. And it's true. It's true. Whoever controls the fiat, they're controlling everything, even the military, because these military weapons has to be paid for, and they don't create these for free. This is why, you know, when people go to war, people that is in the stock market, they get rich. So this is why the wealthy people, they like wars, because when a war break out, guess what? The government's going to have to pay for this machinery. The government's going to have to pay for oil. So every time there's a war, like the big time investors, they make big investments in oil. So yeah, because they know that, like, you know, I don't know if any pay right. attention, but when the Iraq, yeah. when the war broke out in Iraq, the prices of oil went up like I think 40 times the amount. So those people got rich over a few days because it was charging so much for oil. Because with the government, and so all of these wars are strategically, you know, planned. So that they could do that, they get rich. So they tell people, because guess what? They say, well, you need oil to get, you know, get your gasoline in your cars. So I know some of you remember when the price of gas one damn time was like up to $4, like almost $4, man, for regular gas. And so they kept it that way for a few years. But guess what? The people that had investment in the stock markets got rich at that time. And I was listening to some dude, like one of the banks, he was like, wow, you know, we was all, he was like, I hate to say this, but and I'm talking about these corporations. The guy was like, yeah, we was praying that war broke out in Iraq. Because when war breaks out, we know that the prices of oil was going to go up. So he was like, everyone that was in the stock market was just still waiting and praying. He was like, we was literally praying that the war broke out because we all knew it was going to get rich. Because the price of the oil was skyrocket. And so then we just bought into that stock. And he's like, I came out with a few $1 million from that.
Wow.
I mean, that's what's going on, man. It's a dirty game.
That's dirty. Wow.
Yeah. But, yeah, that's what's going on.
Smashed up.
Yep. It's really what's going on in the world, man. People are, like, utterly deceived by, you know, a government that people want to trust and so on and so forth, but just totally, you know, totally deceived, totally thrown out.
Right.
So, you know, right. And so now, you know, when you really look up money, you know, they can't really define what money is. Money, you know, is not, it doesn't have to be like a Federal Reserve note. Remember, according to what I said. So, you know, when people say, well, we don't accept this form of payment, that's not really legal, man. When someone, you, when you're doing an acceptance for value and they saying, well, we don't accept this kind of payment, you got to ask yourself the question, is that legal? I mean, if you fall for that, then that's on you. But they can't, if you know what real money really is, they can't really tell you that. They can't really tell you that. I mean, they could tell you, but it's not really, it's not legal for them to tell you that. But it becomes legal if you believe it and if you allow them to get away with it. Then it becomes legal.
Right.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, when you look at it, Federal Reserve notes were, you know, declared unconstitutional, but they're still in the circulation. Why? They was declared unconstitutional. Because why? Why are they unconstitutional? Because Congress did not have the ability to, you know, give the Federal Reserve Bank or anyone to, like, print money. They only have the power to coin money. Yeah. So when they try to do that, it's not really constitution. It's against the Constitution. But it works because the people sit aside and don't really say anything. You know, most people don't. They don't give a heck what's really going on, man. Most people have no clue what's going on, like, really in this world. So, you know, they do whatever. You know, most people, you know what? Most people do things because someone else is doing it. They do things because a family member was doing it. They don't question anything. You try and talk to some people about this kind of stuff, they think you're crazy. I don't want to hear this. Mm-hmm. This is going to get you in trouble. But, you know, the option is, you know, how is, you know, what you're doing, how is that working out for you? You know, you're complaining, you know, about, you know, so-and-so and someone, but how is that working out for you? You talk to people and they'll tell you how bad it is. You know, if you talk to the average person, good brother, they don't like the job that they're working on. And you know how you could tell? Because they say, wow, thank God it's Friday. If you like doing something, you're not going to say that, right? Thank God it's Friday.
Right.
You said if you like going out to someone, check it out.
True.
If you're going to go and watch a movie or something, right? Or if you're going to an, you know, a amusement park, you're not going to say, oh, thank God, that's over. I'm glad to be out of there, right? You're not saying, oh, wow, I'm looking forward to it, you know? Something that you like, you look forward. You start counting down the days. Oh, wow, it's almost time for me to go on this cruise. I'm so excited about this, right? That's how we're supposed to be feeling, man, about the work that we do. The things that we do, we're supposed to naturally get up and want to do that. Like, we feel, like, elated about doing it. You know what I mean? You're not supposed to be going
enthusiastic. Here today. Yeah.
I hate to go in here today. It's not supposed to be that way, man. But they have us thinking that it's supposed to be that way. You know why? Because they keep people overworked and they keep you stressed out. Like, they keep you distracted with television. They keep you distracted with work. So they pay you. They intentionally don't pay most people enough, which requires people that sometimes have to work two jobs. Because what's happening if you work two jobs? You don't have no time to read. You don't have no time to study. You don't have no time to research because you're too tired. When you come home, you don't feel like doing nothing. So you're too tired. You don't have time to do nothing. You go to sleep. You know, you might sit down. Like, I don't drink. You know, some people come home, they pop a beer and sit down. I'm going to have a beer. He passed out on the sofa trying to watch something because he's so tired from working, you know? But that's how the system is designed to keep you.
Yeah, yeah.
It's designed to keep you like that. And so, you know, the other thing is that they got their minions like the cops, you know? And this, you got to be, this is, think about this, man. You got a job and your primary purpose is to go out and see whose life you can mess up today. It may not seem that way, but that's what a cop's job is. Like, when I was a military police, you know what they tell me? Someone's out there is committing a crime right now as we speak. Your job is to go out there and find them and find someone breaking the law. I'm like, damn, you know, that's kind of messed up when you really think about it. So our job is to go out and just mess someone's life up, you know?
Just messing with people.
That's believe it or not, terrible. Man, some people are just one traffic ticket away from not being able to pay their rent. See, they don't know, many of them do know, they know the effect that it has on some people. Some people really can't afford that. Some people are living from paycheck to paycheck. And one little thing could make a difference in the entire life, man. Their whole life would go into shambles because of that. You know, because people are really struggling, man. You write them a ticket on, now I can't pay my cell phone bill. And they might walk from their phone, you know what I mean? Some people stay at home and they do calling from their phone or whatever. Or, you know, they write the people a ticket. Now they can't pay their car note. And that opens a whole list of problems, man. Because that $200 ticket that you just wrote them, they needed that to pay their car note. Now they can't pay the car note. Yeah. Boom. One finger mends the dike. So now all these other problems come down. Can't pay the car note. 2 months slip by. Now they want to repo the car. Now they can't get to work because they want to see how the problems that they call them. And they know this.
Domino effect.
This is strategically designed, man. It's strategically designed. And so, you know, for the people that say, oh, I don't want to hear that stuff. I mean, because almost every time, man, that I log on to my YouTube page, so, man, this stuff don't work. I'd be glad when they lock all you people up, man. See, those are people that don't realize that they've been programmed from reality. Those kind of people are programmed. Those kind of people are the best types of slaves that you could have because they literally believe that nothing's wrong. Man, you gotta be stupid if you're living in a system like that, like this, and you can't see something's wrong, man. And you can't you see something's wrong? Just how the court system goes, man. You can't see something's wrong with that, man. Something's wrong with that, man. You can't see that it's strategically planned to get us placed in the system. Yeah, I mean, you know, don't you know that? You know, I was looking at statistics because people study us, right? You have people that are social scientists, right? And they study how people socially interact. So, you know, the social scientists say that, you know, if, you know, and I don't know if you guys have noticed, like, there's way more, like, boys in special education than there are girls. So, I don't know if you know also, like, 75% of your educators in their earlier years in school, in primary school, are white females, right? So knowing this, and I'm not just speaking out of the side of my neck, I've done research on it, right? So knowing this, like, these white women, many of them have never, ever interacted with a black man, right? They don't know. They grew up in two total different communities, so they don't know how to relate to young so-called black boys, right? So now the school system is set up in such a way that, you know, the tests are biased because we don't learn the same way that they do. And men don't learn the same way that females learn, right? Because tests has actually proven that females could actually sit in one place longer than a guy can. But because men has testosterone, men are very energetic. And so are young boys. And so scientifically, they've proven that, you know, melanated boys and men have more testosterone than your Euro Gentiles, right? So the so-called young black boy, it becomes exceedingly difficult for him to sit in a classroom setting for long periods of time without taking recess. So what happens is he starts to become like a little bit frustrated because he wants to move around and he doesn't use the same learning process that females learn. Like, females are usually more tentative. They can set over longer periods of time. So when the boy becomes like, you know, becomes like a little anxious, the teachers say, all right, sit down, Johnny. You sit down and you be quiet like everyone else. So, but he's active. He needs to get up and move around. He can't sit for these long periods of time. You know what they call it? They call that, you know, ADHD. He's too hyper. He has an attention deficit. He can't sit still long enough. But that's really not the problem. It's just that he's a male and he's much more active. And he has a lot of testosterone in him. So, you know, that's kicking in. So he needs to get out and be active. And so to prove So what they start to say is that, well, these boys, they have learning deficiencies because they can't pay attention long enough. But if you took, and I looked at some of these studies by Kalanja Kajufi, you know, he was saying how that these same children, they can memorize like all the lyrics in a rap song. So he was suggesting to the teachers, he was suggesting to the teachers that if you use like a different learning method, that these boys could actually learn also. And he proved it. But you know, they've determined that if a boy is actually not reading on the reading level that he should actually be on by the fourth grade, then those boys are actually going to end up in the special education. And those boys that go into special education, like about 95% of those boys end up going to jail or prison by the time they're 18 or 21. So they already has it plotted out that if a black boy, and guess what? Children that usually go to special education usually never get out of special education. They usually never get out. So they're saying by age, by the fourth grade, if the black boy is not usually reading on the reading level that he should be on, he is going to be in the special education. And if he's in the special education, he's usually going to go to jail by the time he's 18 or 21, one or two times. This is how they've actually literally plotted this out. And it's very, very, very accurate. It's very accurate. And that's real talk. So, you know, I say, and I'll say this to you sisters, man. This is one thing that I don't agree with a lot of black women. You are responsible for putting a lot of these young black boys in the special education. And then when they get them in there, they'll tell them they have ADHD and they'll put them on some psych job, on Ritalin or something. And so the effects that these drugs have is that if you don't have a chemical imbalance, these drugs create a chemical imbalance in that kid's mind and the kid's never right again. He's never right again because now he become dependent on that drug and he needs it to function. And then when he doesn't have the drug, he loses it. So this is why you see a lot of these Edomites, they go into these movie theaters and these schools and they shoot it up. It's because they have them on these drugs. If you look at most of these people that's done these like mass shootings, they're usually on some sort of psych drug, on some sort of psych med. So when they don't take it for a while, what happens? They lose it. They are out of touch with reality and they go and shoot up a mass of people and they don't even realize what happened sometimes after they've done it. So, you know, before you put your son, because there's not a lot of, if you look in special education, there's far more black boys than black girls in special education. There's more white boys in special education than there is white girls. And so you got to start to look and say, hey, what's going on here? And it's because the school system in the earlier years are dictated by white women. Those are mostly your teachers. So if you see a black male that's teaching, you usually don't see him until you're up in the higher, you know, at least middle school or high school. But by then it's too late because a boy is already reading on a substandard level and he usually never gets off of that level. And that creates a tremendous problems in our communities. And it's woefully sad. It's woefully sad for real.
Wow.
So I mean, that's utterly what's going on, man. It's utterly what's going on. And that's, you know, it's happening at an extremely alarming rate. And so, you know, these black children, they put on these, you know, psych meds and they were trying, you know, if you're weak enough, they would try and force it on, hey, son, I just noticed that such and such is a little bit hyperactive and so on and so forth. You may want to consider talking to a counselor. Like, so I'm telling you, man, like, if you ever get a note from the school and they're saying, well, we just noticed about Lil Ray Ray. He's really hyper. So we're gonna have a meeting at the school, and they had that school psychiatrist there, and well, I forgot what that other
child study team.
Yeah, child study. They're trying to get your son to go to special ed, and they may even want to consider putting him on meds. Don't go for it, because guess what? They can't do it without the parents' consent. And this is what I'm not getting, why so many children are on this, because they cannot do it without the parents' consent. So they'll shut the parent down and convince her that something's wrong with her son. And so, because she wants a check, because she's getting a free check out of this, because guess what? If they say he's in special ed and they put him on meds, guess what? Now they're going to say he's entitled to disability. So a lot of these women do it, because she just simply wants to check. But she's ruined that. She's ruining that child's entire life, man. Some of them never come back from it. Most of them don't.
Yeah, yo, Tazadaq, that's actually the truth, because I'm one of those childs, man, that they did that to, you know. As a child growing up, this child was too hyper, and I was diagnosed with ADHD and bipolar or whatever. And I was also put into special ed. And they convinced my mother. Yeah, they convinced my mother to put me on medication. And ever since, you know, I've been taking meds here and there when I was young. And, man, it wasn't the same. It was really depressing because, you know, as a young kid, you know, we learn off the experience, you know. So we like to jump around, touch things, because we want to feel things for ourselves. And, you know, they just really convinced my mother that something is wrong with me, that I can't sit down and focus, exactly what you were saying. And, you know, they got me involved with medication, and I was in special ed. And ever since I turned 17, you know, I've been going to program and foster homes back and forth. You know, I've been to juveniles as a youngster, you know, and I've been locked up a few times. And, man, I just went deep inside myself, and I'm like, yo, I know I'm better than this. And, you know, I signed myself off of medication, and I had to detox. And
what happened to you? I think unmute yourself.
Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. I can hear you now. I'm getting a lot of noise from someone, man.
Yeah, it's annoying. Yeah. So what you're saying, man, is absolutely true. Cause that's exactly what they did to me, man. They did exactly what you just explained. They did that to me. They diagnosed me with ADHD and bipolar. And I was in special ed, and I learned off the experience, but they didn't understand that. They just said I was too hyper, and I can't focus. You know, they put me in, like, after-school programs. And sometimes I just, you know, I was kind of stubborn, so I didn't want to, you know, deal with it. So I even got into foster homes, you know, and I went downhill. And then, I don't know, one day I turned 17, 18, and I signed myself off the medication. I did some detoxing. And ever since then, I was able to cope with my original self, you know. And I'm still going through that, you know. I'm like, you know, I'm picking up where I left off. So it's absolutely true, King.
But I mean, it's usually, you know, the thing is, King, it's usually nothing wrong with those children. You know what I mean? They just don't understand it. You just got a lot of energy. So you got to channel that energy, especially with a male child, man. He needs to be out playing, active into things like that. I mean, that's generally our nature, you know what I mean? But I've seen that happen to us. I used to work at Mount Sinai, and, you know, and I worked in a psych ward there for a second. And so on what they call like six West, they have like a little children's psych ward. And so I would see little children coming in there, man, and they were shooting them up with the Ritalin and all of that. And, you know, you see the kid one day, he's like a normal kid. But then when I would come back like a week later and I see the kid, he's like a zombie. Like, I mean, he's like just out. He like lose bladder control. Like he urinated on himself. And then if they would act up, you know, they would throw him in a quiet room. You know, like this room that had like these real thick walls and all that. Just throw him in there like an animal. I'm like, yo, this is kind of like prison. You know, it's
like, they lock the door.
You know? Like, this is crazy. And then, you know, even the adults, like, they couldn't get out, like, on their own. Like, they had to be signed out by a family member or had to be, like, a court order. So once you was in there, like, you couldn't get out on your own. It's like a prison. You know, yep. Like a prison. You couldn't get out. And they had like bulletproof windows and everything there. Because one cat, he tried to take the like chair and break the window and it just reflected off of the window. It's like a big, thick bulletproof thing. So it's like they was in prison and you couldn't get out of the front door because they had to buzz you out. And the lady was actually behind the this cubicle thing inside of like a little room that was a locked door. So they couldn't even get out because you had to be buzzed out. Even the staff had to be buzzed out.
Yep.
You couldn't open the door. They had to buzz you out.
So, and another thing too, man, that I've been through that. That's absolutely true. And another thing, man, if you refuse to take the medication, man, they will strain you. They will strain you and they'll give it to you in a needle form, man. And then they'll have you jacked up. Or they put you on the mat, you know, and they get like, you know, a couple staff and they'll hold you down and make sure you take the damn drug, man. And it's messed up, man, because it's really doing damage to the body, you know. Like, I knew it was doing damage, but nobody understand me, and most of them didn't care. And my mother, I don't know where her head was, but, you know, that's my mother. I still love her, though. So, but I was glad I was old enough, and I signed myself up for that medication, and then I just had to, like, you know, learn how to cope with the original self, you know what I'm saying? Because after a while, when you do take these medications, you do get a chemical imbalance, and you're not going to function the same, you know what I'm saying? So in order to, you know, to get back, you really have to, like, you know what's going on. And I don't know, I'm just grateful to, like, be able to get myself out of that situation because, you know, I could have been lost, you know what I mean? I could have been locked up doing something dumb, but, you know, I thank the Most High for that, you know, so.
I was looking for this book I have read like two books on it. I hope that, you know, the brother was talking about how, you know, if a melanated child, you know, reaches the fourth grade and he's not on his reading level, you know, they'll end up sending him to special ed. And then essentially he ends up doing some prison time. There's only a few that really breaks through the cracks and don't go through that process, man. And that's
usually has no father, you know? Yeah, and I've been to programs like group homes and all that, where they put you away and you don't come out to a certain age. And a lot of brothers in there was like, you know, melanated, man. They was like, you know, so I'm like, yo, it was like, you know, a small portion of like whites and so-called Hispanics, but the majority of them was melanated, you know, kids, man, copper-colored kids, man. And it was like, it didn't make sense because that's the same thing that's going on with jail. So they're like, you know, they start you out young, man. Crazy.
Yeah. One of the books is called Countering the Conspiracy to Destroy Black Boys. Yeah, he was talking about a lot of that stuff in his book, man. He's really going in on it. Like, you know, how they trying to get him on meds and he was talking about the attention spans and so on and so forth. Like, you know, it's kind of sad, man. And then he went into the psychology of why do black men kill black men. It's a pretty good book, man. I would recommend people like really read that.
Yeah, what was the name of it? Again, I'm sorry.
Channeling the Conspiracy to Destroy Black Boys. The series of books that
got it.
Yeah, I recommend that a lot of schools read the book.
Yeah. Yeah, people need to know about this, man, because what they're doing, man, is like, it's really cruel. And what hurts is like, you know, I got my parents consented to it. So, like, I was being abused, you know what I'm saying? And I had no say over my own body, you know what I'm saying? I don't want to take these medications. I knew there was nothing wrong with me. I was just hyper, you know, being, you know, a regular kid, what a regular kids do. I like to climb trees, you know, and run around and all that stuff. And it's like, it's crazy, you know, they make you take these drugs, and man, it's just, it's mad cruel, man. And it's like, you know, it's horrible. And if we could put a stop to that, that'd be great. You'll definitely see a big difference, you know, especially on the youth.
Oh yeah. The other one is actually keeping black boys out of special education. That was a good one also by the same guy.
Kwanzaa. Okay,
yeah. Both of these books is like really, really good books, man. Like really, really deep. He's really and he's talking about gender learning differences and how they're like tests, you know, are not really designed for us because we have different learning styles. It was like most schools try and teach boys the same way that they teach girls, but it's been proven that we have two different styles of learning, you know?
Yeah.
And but like you're saying, he was just talking about, you know, most of these people are Latin and black boys.
Right. Who is the author of these books?
Hey, I just wanted to say in the room, I homeschool my kids, and my kids, they're very hyperactive, but they learn better when they are allowed in class to move around, get up and jump and down. And even though they're not looking at me in my face or, you know, looking at me, they can still relay the message back to me, even if they're playing around.
Yeah, that's what's up, King. Like, I mean, Queen, I highly recommend, you know, homeschooling kids, you know. And, yeah, kids is going to be hyping, man. That's how they learn. They learn off the experience. They want to touch. They want to feel. They want to know, you know. So, yeah. Ain't nothing wrong with
you. Explore. That's what they do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but check this out. So let me read you something. Like, on page 21, right, for example, right? He's talking about why so many black boys and Hispanic boys end up in special education. He said, Janet Herrera and the disproportionate placement of African Americans in special education. An analysis of 10 cities reported that there is a relationship between the number of white teachers and the number of black male students placed in special education. The cities with the highest percentage of white teachers had the highest percentage of black students identified in special education. For example, in New York City, 30% of students are black, but 67% of the special education students are black. Can you imagine that? And so at the same time, white teachers are counted at 77% of the teachers in New York City. So the following list of cities from the highest percentage of white teachers to the lowest. So what he's saying is that where there is more white teachers in the schools, there's more black boys in special education. So New York was listed as number one, Milwaukee as number two, Miami as number three, San Diego is number four, Cleveland as number five, Houston number six, Atlanta number seven, Detroit number eight, Chicago number nine, and Washington, D.C. is number 10. And who's that with that noise, man? So he also said that we acknowledge the race is a factor, that racism is affecting the placement of African Americans in special education. Then we either need to change the personnel making the referrals or change the behavior and thought process of our existing teaching force. So basically, he said the only way to fix this is you got to change the people that's referring these black boys to special education, or you just got to change the entire educational system. So, you know, that's what he's saying. So he's saying since Brown versus the Department of Topeka Board of Education in 1954, there's been 66% decline in African-American teachers. So 66%. So there has only been 66% decline in African-American teachers. Presently, only 7% of the American Teaching Corps is African American. Only 7%. So guess who's teaching your students? Euro Gentiles. So it says American males account for only 1% of the teaching force. Only 1% is American black males. So that goes to say a lot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he said, unfortunately, an African-American boy can go to school from kindergarten to sixth grade without ever experiencing an African-American teacher. And so remember, by fourth grade, if they haven't gotten it, it's too late.
Wow.
So you know, some of the stuff that you know you were saying, look, some of the other stuff he's talking about, 80% of all students refer to special education are below grade level in reading. That's 80%. 85% of all special education students receive drugs. 85%. So 85% of students that's in special education receives drugs, like Ritalin and all that. Only 27% of African-American male special education students graduate from high school. So out of all the students that's going to special education, only 27% of those black boys will graduate from high school. So, you know, the other 73% don't graduate. Don't graduate. Only 41% of African-American male regular students graduate from high school. So guess what? Out of 100% of the African-American boys that go to high school, only 41% is going to graduate anyways. That's woefully sad. That's sad. So if you count off 100, for every 100 so-called black men that you see, black boys going to school, only 41% is going to graduate. The other one is going to drop out and not going to make it. Now, check this out, King.
Wow.
40% of special education students become addicted to drugs. 40%. That's almost half. So they get these children addicted to drugs. Less than 10% of special education students return to stay in mainstream school. So like I said, once they're in special education, they pretty much stay there. Now check this out. 80% of special education referrals are generated by teachers. By teachers. And guess who? The Euro Gentile and female.
Mm-mm-mm.
Now, there's a 4-to-1 ratio of African American males to African American females in special education. What does that go to say? Does that mean the female's smarter? Nope. Nope. Ritalin is the fifth leading drug in America after nicotine, alcohol, cocaine, and marijuana. So guess what's next? So Ritalin. Guess who's taking Ritalin? The children. These young black boys.
Yeah.
That's the drug they're shooting them up with.
Ritalin, Concerta, Zyprexa. There's a lot of names. They got a bunch of them, man. They got a whole variety.
So it also says prison projects, they're new constructions on the current fourth grade reading level, like I said. So all of the students that's not reading on the level where they should be at fourth grade, the prisons is building prisons for them children because they're saying they're going to end up in prison. So, you know, the problem is in America, you know, people are not comfortable talking about racism, but this is what's causing this, man. And one thing that irks me is these black people that always want to come to damn Esau's rescue, man. What do you think's causing this, man? They're causing this. This is strategically planned. They're doing this. They're literally putting these boys in special education because guess what? They don't like a young black boy that comes in with a brilliant mind and questions them. They don't like that. They take that offensively. They take that as a threat, man. So people don't like to talk about racism. It makes it much easier. They don't like to say race is a factor in this. It's much easier to talk about sexism and things like that. But hey, don't talk about racism. They don't like to talk about that. Let me get some more of these dynamics. Let's see what we have here. So one of the other things that he's saying, he says, you know, what they're trying to do is to get black boys to be like white girls, to have that learning style. So he's saying the attempt to force such psychological programs on black boys has had a catastrophic impact on their self-worth, family dynamics, community stability, and social economic system at large. So he's saying, you know, the methods in which they're trying to teach the black boys, it's the same methods that they teach young white girls with. And that's not the method that they should be trying to use to teach black boys. Then he goes on and says that the public schools are breaking the spirits of African-American males. How do you think a black boy feels when he sees white children receiving warnings while he receives special education placement suspensions for behaving in similar ways? So he's saying that they'll give the white student a warning, but they'll suspend the black boy. So he's saying like the schoolhouse is a jailhouse trap. So the schools is actually preparing you for jail.
Wow.
Yep. He's saying, so he's talking about this boy named Willie. He said, while Willie was in third grade with a master teacher, he was not labeled ADD or ADHD, but with an effective teacher in the fourth grade, he's now label with ADHD. So he's saying a lot of this is the teacher don't know how to teach. A lot of these teachers don't know how to teach.
Right.
Yeah, which is crazy, man. So he said one of the major factors driving the disproportionate placement of African-American males in the special education is poor classroom management, which goes back to the teacher. The problem may not be with the behavior of the African-American males. It may be with the teachers who have poor classroom management techniques. How many people thought about that? So he said, point one, then he's citing examples. Children who misbehave to get attention. They're trying to feel significant and create a sense of belonging by drawing attention to themselves. See that? Then he says children who misbehave to achieve power. He said in this situation, children are trying to feel important and be connected to others by asserting themselves in a strong way. And then he said children who misbehave to seek revenge. In this particular scenario, children want to be compensated for feeling hurt and, you know, by deprivation of importance. So he's saying, you know, pretty much the teacher is supposed to, you know, look into why these children are misbehaving, not just saying, hey, well, they're misbehaving, doing more some psych drug or something of that nature.
Right.
Listen, man, most of these teachers, man, they don't care. They don't, like, they don't care if something's wrong with your kid. They're not going to look into it, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm not saying all teachers, they don't care, but majority of them, they don't care, man. Like, they're not going to look in to see if something's wrong with your child, you know, or see the reason why. They're just going to tell them there's something wrong, he needs medication, and that's that, because it's easy for them to deal with, you know? So there's only a few that have a good heart that will, like, sit down one-on-one and see what's really going on, you know? But that's really about it, you know?
It's actually in schools, preschools, so, you know, preschools place to have. It's sad.
Yeah, we can't hear you. You're like really broken up. You're like really broken up, KO. Can't hear you.
But school that I'm certain here is something like a bad. It's a question of discernment. That is like men feel you have peace with her, that this just is a kind of and find out the causes, right, that it's, you know, their home, they're so the kid, you know, school, attend, like, right, straight place to, you know, want to be a part of any issue line, we can, you know, but it's really something simple is not, you know, really best and do everybody slave, you know, with workers.
I didn't
know. Breaking up pretty bad, KO.
Yeah, I don't think anyone understood a word of that, KO.
Yeah.
Oh, child.
Yeah, I can't hear anything. It's like really gibberish. Can't understand any of it. So, according to this brother, he said 80% of students who are recommended for special education placement are below grade level in reading. 63% of African American fourth grade students are below grade level in reading. 74 million Americans read below the eighth grade level. 85% of juveniles coming before the courts are functional illiterate. 70% of prison inmates are illiterate. So, you know, see, it goes back to literacy. It goes back to not being able to read.
Wow. We have to teach our children how to read.
Right. So, I mean, you know, it says, you know, a personal prayer was taken out of the schools in 1962. The very next year, the SAT scores declined for the very first time, and teenage pregnancy increased when prayer was taken out of school. You see what happened when they take the Most High, right? You see?
Yes, sir.
And mind you that this country was so-called founded on biblical principles. But now they removed the Bible from the school. They removed prayer from the school. They removed 10 commandments from the school. And the SAT scores went down, but pregnancy went up. What does that goes to say?
Morality has increased.
But check this out. There's more. In 1930, America had an illiterate rate of only 4%. But today, it's increased almost 42%, that amount. Yeah, 74 million Americans now illiterate.
Wow.
Yeah, and they say that Boys are supposed to master reading by age 7. If not, they're preparing them for prison.
Wow.
So now he was talking about like the left brain reader. He said for a left brain reader, reading aloud is inappropriate. So what he was saying is that melanated boys are left brain readers. So when they read aloud, a left brain reader don't read as well. The right brain readers read better when they're reading aloud. It's just a long message for them.
All right.
Yeah, so he said for a left brain reader, aloud is inappropriate, but for the right brain, visual learners who create images as they read, so the people that read best is the people that read with the right side of their brain, because while they're reading, they create an image as they read. So reading aloud is not only, difficult, someone that's actually, reading aloud is not only difficult, but it slows them down. Reading aloud, it makes it difficult to create the mental images that's needed to comprehend and enjoy the text. So he said some of these students, you know, everybody's not meant to read aloud. Like some people read silent. So people that read with the right side of their brain, like these black boys, when they are reading out loud, they lose the ability to read well because they're trying to create that image in their mind. So he say, while right brain ADD children may have difficulties reading aloud, nature gives them a compensating strength from which to work. They can be excellent silent readers and speed readers. So these people are not designed to read loud. You see what I'm saying? So they're trying to get them to go against something that nature or the Most High has actually instilled in them. But the public school system believes that everyone reads and learns the same way. But he says a right brain learner is placed in special education because when he's reading aloud, he has difficulties making pictures. He needs to understand the text. So he creates pictures in his mind so that he could actually understand the text that he's reading. And then he says, lastly, a child who needs to hear the words is placed in special education because he has difficulties reading silent. So, you know, it's like they don't look at any of this. So he's saying teachers need to realize that you don't teach the way that you want to teach, but you should be teaching in the style that the child could actually learn from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, wow. How many people do that?
I notice I when I read, I prefer to read in silence. You know?
Yeah, me too.
I like that better. And I absorb a whole lot like that. I mean, it's like reading out loud, it's just like it's just reading. And to me, you know, But when I'm like reading in silent, I can absorb more. And,
right.
Yeah. You know, it's better for me. It works for me that way. You know.
Right. Yep. Yeah. So, I mean, there's a lot of things that's going on here, man, that, you know, these teachers, and they don't have no clue, you know. They don't know that. They don't have no clue. They're just going by some curriculum, and you know,
yeah.
They don't have no clue.
They're not even teaching that, them, man.
It's your style of teaching. It's not the children. It's your
right.
Method of teaching.
They so need the teaching.
And it's making that boy sit there for that long period of time, because you guys say, you know, there's gender learning differences. So he's saying in an 8-hour-long class, boys' attention span will average about 8 minutes. Some researchers say 22 minutes. What are the consequences of giving a 30 to 50-minute lesson to a student with a 8 to 22-minute attention span. You see what I'm saying? So he's saying that average boy right. attention span only lasts for 8 minutes. But you giving him something for 50 minutes, his attention span is not that long. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
But they don't any of them.
And they want to claim him as being disruptive in class. Wow. That's crazy.
Wow. Somebody just popped into the chat room. Don't belong here.
Yeah, it's already put there. Let's see if I could get him out of here. He put in here, just look at how niggas act. It's probably the same buffoon that, you know, comes on every week.
I think DA stands for District Attorney, not Dark Knight.
I beg to dumbass. Yeah, it probably stands more for dumbass. DA.
Oh man.
It just popped up in the chat room, man. I gotta figure out how to deal with these. Let me see if I see them over here. TA. Wow. Anyways, man. So it says, you know, given, you know, a boy that had an attention span of 8 to 22 minutes, 50-minute test or exam, the consequences are actually not favorable. So, you know, this is why they foresee a lot of them as having problems. And right. he's saying their motor skills are different. So it's just a lot of stuff that, you know, is dark night. Every week, man, we get some, like, weird spirit that comes in the room, like Satan. The enemy's like always at work, man.
Right.
I gotta block this dude, man. Let me see. DA. He got nothing better to do with his time, man. Nothing better to do with his time. What a loser, man. To close the chat, but I don't want to do that. Gotta learn this. I don't see how to kick this guy out. Gotta learn more about this talk show, man. To be able to kick people out. But I mean, that's what it is, man. So we gotta, Yaya Bey, you still on the call?
I mean,
you really have someone on the call that actually have firsthand experience. You know, they trying to, oh, you said I'm back. Oh,
Wow.
Well, okay. Asshole. I mean, all he's doing is like really typing, texting, whatever. I don't.
It's just the devil. He a fleek.
Yeah. I resist his ass if I can get my hands on it.
I think we all might put a hand on it.
It would be a real dark night.
Hand and feet
him.
On him.
Yeah, it would be a real dark night for him, man. Yeah. Yeah,
of course,
like that. Yeah, he
would have a real dark life. Practice dummy. Hit him up
with some Wing Chun. Yeah, he sound like a real superhero, man. But yeah, man. So, I mean, it's people like him that kind of, you know, solidifies everything that you be talking about. But one of these dudes that was coming on the call, man, was actually a coon that really had nothing better to do with his time. He was a coon. You know, he's trying to portray himself as an Edomite, but he was really a coon. Trying to behave like an Edomite because, I mean, I went back and I listened to the call. And the guy was actually a coon. You know, he wasn't even really a Edomite. You know, he's trying to come off like he was an Edomite. So, you know, he got a lot of haters, you know, your own people. It's sad, but it's true.
Wow.
It's probably him right there. Yeah. I mean, because who else? You know, you got nothing better to do with your time, man. It's like 11 something that night. You come on a call, you know, grown man, and just portraying theatrics, making a fool out of himself. Like we say, Edomites or Jews, you moron. Yeah, this is probably him right here. This is probably him right here, man.
Ooh.
Hey, King. I see you on the video, man. I found a way to do it, so be clear.
Oh, you say you see me on the video? Yeah.
I just figured out how to do it.
All right. Yeah, I can't. Dude, I don't know. He's just in the chat. He's not even in the the main room. I can't even really see him unless I switch over to the chat. Yeah. Let me see what happens if I close this, man. But anyway, anyone got anything they want to bring on? Close the chat room. Close the chat. Are you still typing? Wow, man. But anyone got anything? Anyone got anything they want to bring out? Anything else? Because
I was just gonna go back on that that subject matter. Some of these teachers, they actually know.
Please enter the show address followed by the pound key. You can access the episode up to 15 minutes before the scheduled start time.
Why not, man?
All right, but I was gonna say some of these teachers, they actually know that.
Show ID is not valid.
Damn, I'm on mute.
Welcome to TalkShoe.
Yeah, I think it's probably that dude.
15 minutes before the scheduled start time.
Let me see. Who new just popped up? Who was that?
It's not valid. Welcome to TalkShoe. Please enter the show ID followed by the pound key. You can ask.
But go ahead. I'll figure out who this is.
Scheduled start time.
I was gonna say some of these teachers that, because my kids are homeschooled, and some of these teachers they actually know there's a different learning curve for boys and girls. They actually know, you know what I mean? They actually know how come there's not a different criteria or set, you know, a schedule for them. But it's just, and they're like, oh, it is just what it is. That's why I mean, some of these guys they just know, and it's just not. The system's just not right. Some of the teachers know it.
Please enter the show ID followed by the pound key.
That's all I want to say.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. A lot of them do know, man. But hey, it's how they stay on top, man. It's part of. I mean, how can so few control so many for so long, man? You gotta have some type of strategic plan in place. You know, people don't like to talk about that, but you know, it's the real truth, man. It's a shame that people got to be like that, but it's the way it really is, man. So you got to go against you from every field of endeavor, whatever way that they can, man. So yeah,
just try to keep people down. That's all they do.
Man, mute this dude. You know, way of controlling this thing right here, man. Okay, hold on, let's see. Okay. We were registered members. Chat. Let's see if that gets whatever. So yeah, man, yeah, that's about it for me. I gotta get up kind of early. I've been like all over the place, but yeah, babe. It's kind of good that you made it through that, man. That was the most high right there. That had to be the most high.
Yeah, man. That's a total, man. Just you know, thanks. You know, I mean, everything was in very good information. Good. You know, I appreciate what you do. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't really go into it too much tonight, man. Not that big.
I mean, that's all right. Hey, man. I mean, I said I managed to stay up, man. I'm good now, man. I mean, I feel great, you know. And I learned some things that I didn't know. Yep, that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I.
Yeah, man.
So, Bay, I might need you to control the camera for me, man. Like when I get over there, because Xanadu is not going to be coming.
Oh, yeah. I got you, King. You like, rely on me, man.
Oh, man. Sorry.
But all right, man. So, yeah, I guess, you know, I'm going to sign off for this, man. Trying to get some sleep. I got to get up kind of early. Got to make some moves.
Indeed,
yeah.
Indeed.
Yeah. So, you know, I thank everyone for tuning in. I saw Shannon do it. Looked like he was logged on the call earlier, but he logged off. Looked like a lot of people logged off. I don't know if they didn't know how to use it or what, but I'm looking, it looks like about 30, 40 people logged in and logged out. I don't know if it's they didn't know how to use it or what, because there's a lot of things here saying left the call, left the call, left the call, left the call, left the call. And I see he was like at the very bottom, and he actually logged in and left the call. Yeah. So I don't know if they was having problems with using it, because it kind of took like a little minute to like figure out how to use the thing. But it seems cool once it's up and running. But yeah, so you know, thank everybody for tuning.